All right, good afternoon. A couple of personnel, senior personnel appointments to announce. The Secretary General is appointing Charlotte Petri Gornitska of Sweden as Assistant Secretary General to serve as the Deputy Executive Director for Partnerships at UNICEF. Ms. Petri Gornitska, who recently served as the Chair of the Development Assistant Committee for the OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation in Development, brings to the position 20 years of experience in international development. She has successfully built innovative partnerships with leaders from civil society, national governments, and the private sector to deliver program results and influence critical policy changes. And the Secretary General also today is announcing the appointment of Ingrid Hayden of Australia as his Deputy Special Representative for Political Affairs for the UN Assistance Mission in Afghanistan. With over 27 years of distinguished service with the UN, Ms. Hayden has served as the Acting Deputy Special Representative in Afghanistan since January of this year. She has extensive work experience for the UN in the areas of peace and security management, including in Afghanistan, Cambodia, the Central African Republic, Chad, Sudan, South Sudan, and Timor-Leste. And this morning, the Secretary General spoke at the Peacebuilding Commission's meeting on leadership, accountability, and capacities. He said that for effective, responsive, and accountable leadership, supported for the right capacities and resources, lies at the heart of his vision for sustaining peace. He also noted the need to invest more and much earlier in prevention and peacebuilding. He added it's important to work together to enhance the authority and capacities of UN leaders and their teams, particularly those who work in conflict areas, as they navigate a complex and politically sensitive environment while operating with limited staff resources. The Secretary General also called for an increase in contributions to the Peacebuilding Fund, which often plays a catalytic role in assisting countries seeking to build and sustain peace. In addition, he highlighted the progress in allocating more resources to gender parity. Last year, he said Peacebuilding Fund devoted 36% of its funds for projects supporting women's peacebuilding work. Full remarks are online. And as you will have just seen, Staffan de Mistura, the Special Envoy for Syria, briefed the Security Council by video conference on the situation in Idlib. He said the situation there had all the ingredients of a perfect storm with devastating humanitarian consequences. He noted reports suggesting the increased deployment of the Syrian government and allied forces near the Idlib de-escalation zone. The Special Envoy said that the dangers are profound and that any battle for Idlib would be horrific and bloody. He said the efforts of combating terrorism do not supersede obligations under international law, and he urged all sides to find a formula to avert a tragedy in Idlib. John Ging of the Office of the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs told the Council there's 3 million people living in Idlib de-escalation zone, which includes parts of Idlib, Aleppo and Latakia, and Hama governorates. Of these, he said 2.1 million people are in need of humanitarian assistance, including 1.4 million people who are internally displaced. He added that humanitarian aid is already being positioned inside Idlib, including ready-to-eat food rations sufficient for 1 week to cover as many as 850,000 people, both through cross-border operations via Turkey and from inside Syria. And regarding Myanmar, UNHCR, the UN Refugee Agency, the UN Development Program, said they stand ready to commence assessment activities in 23 villages following the signing of a memorandum of understanding by the two agencies and the government of Myanmar 3 months ago. These assessments will be a first step only, with the expectations that access would be expanded to allow for large-scale comprehensive assessment that continue to be needed. The assessment is the initial list of villages or part of a broader work plan that has been under discussion with the authorities in Myanmar since July. By commencing with needs assessment to identify and implement quick impact projects, UNHCR and UNDP hope to jumpstart confidence-building measures aimed at rebuilding trust and social cohesions with those communities that remain in Rakhine State. Substantial progress, however, remains urgently needed in three key areas covered by the MOU: granting effective access in Rakhine State, ensuring freedom of movement for all communities, and addressing the root causes of the crisis, including a clear pathway to citizenship for those who are eligible. And Our colleagues in the Department of Political Affairs informed us that they marked the official closure today of its Nepal liaison office that was established in 2011 following the closure of the UN mission in Nepal. For the past two decades, the UN has accompanied the Nepali government and Nepali leaders on the country's pathway to peace, including the 2006 Comprehensive Agreement. Nepal's homegrown and nationally owned peace process reached an important milestone following the adoption of an inclusive and democratic constitution in 2015 and completion of three-tier elections in 2017. The UN is committed to continue to work with Nepali political leaders and civil society in consolidating the peace agenda, including on broader human rights development goals towards a future of sustained peace and prosperity. And on the 4th of September, a few days ago, a joint UN and government team conducted a joint assessment mission in the north and south Hanguoi provinces of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, following the late August heavy rains and flash floods in that area. Needs have to be identified in the sector of food security, nutrition, health, water, sanitation, shelter, and disaster risk reduction. Currently, many areas in the area remain inaccessible as bridges and roads have been destroyed. The floods follow a period of high temperature in July and August, which already affected crop production in the provinces considered to be the food basket of the country. Some 40% of the population is food insecure and undernourished in the Democratic People's Republic of Korea. And a note from Colombia, the UN Verification Mission has informed us that in recent weeks, six leaders of the four territorial areas for training and reintegration in one new regrouping point in the southeastern region of the country decided to leave these areas and abandon their responsibilities to approximately 1,500 combatants residing there. Our colleagues in the mission are closely monitoring the situation and have confirmed that despite the departure of these leaders, the ex-combatants and their families continue to live, study, work there, and remain committed to the reintegration process. The mission stressed renewed government support for productive reintegration is now needed more than ever and called upon the National Reincorporation Council and its working groups to resume with their efforts to implement projects with community-based approach. It added that these southeastern areas, former FARC EP members and their families have developed more than 40 productive projects, which are fundamental to the effective reintegration of those individuals. And in the Central African Republic, our colleagues at the peacekeeping mission there strongly condemned the killing of a number of internally displaced people in Bria in Haute-Coteau Prefecture by alleged members of the ex-Celica FPRC. The peacekeeping police are investigating reports that the people from the PK3 camp for internally displaced people were abducted Thursday outside the camp and reportedly killed. The mission received information about the bodies and sent a patrol who found the deceased people on the Ipi road axis. The mission has increased the security of the three around the PK3 camp to protect the population. The peacekeeping mission urges all armed groups to avoid, to stop violence against civilians and end the current tensions in Bria. It reiterates the perpetrators of these attacks, against civilians, must be arrested and brought to justice. And the Secretary General's Special Representative for Children in Armed Conflict, Virginia Gamba, just wrapped up a four-day visit to South Sudan. She said that grave violations against children in the country remain unacceptable high levels, with close to 1,400 children verified as having been directly affected in 2017 and thousands more bearing the brunt of the conflict. Ms. Gamba called on all parties committed grave violations against children to take immediate concrete actions to end the devastating number of violations and prevent them from reoccurring. More information on a press release. And the International Labour Organization, the ILO, welcomed Qatar's decision to end exit visa requirements for most of its migrant workers. The Director General of the International Labour Organization, Guy Ryder, said in a tweet that this is, quote, a positive step towards decent work, and added that the agency is committed to working with the Qatari government as it pursues other reforms. The Secretary General adds his welcome to the voice of ILO on this development. And the FAO says that 45 countries renewed their commitments to globally eradicate by 2030 the peste des petits ruminants, the PPR, a highly contagious and devastating disease responsible for the death of millions of sheep and goat sheep, excuse me, millions of sheep and goats every year. At a global conference organized by FAO and the World Organization for Animal Health in Brussels, participants stressed that PPR directly threatens the livelihoods of poorest people in their countries, noting that diseases cost more than $2.1 billion of economic losses every year. And I want to flag that on Monday, a reminder that on Monday at 11 a.m., there'll be an embargoed briefing here by the Secretary General of the World Meteorological Organization, Professor Pateri Talas. And at 3 p.m., and that's in conjunction with the 3 p.m. event, at which the Secretary General will deliver a major address on climate change on the North Lawn. If it rains, it will take place in the delegates' dining room. The Secretary General will outline the danger, highlight solutions, and emphasize the need for greater ambition and stronger leadership addressing what he has called the defining threat of our time. We look forward to seeing you there. Habibi, go ahead.
Thank you, Stefan. I have two questions. The first one is about Syria. We saw Secretary General's statement about Idlib. Has the Secretary General made any contacts with the relevant parties, any discussions about the imminent military operation there?
You know, he has been discussing the issue notably with during his monthly lunch with the Security Council, and of course Mr. De Mistura has himself been in contact with all the relevant parties.
My second question is about the developments in Iraq. In the oil-rich city of Basra, there has been mass protest, government buildings being burned. Just a few hours ago, the Iranian consulate has been burned by mobs. Several protesters got killed. Any comments about the development in Basra?
Yes, of course. You know, we've been watching this closely, as has the mission there, Mr. Kubish. We very much regret the tragic loss of life during the demonstrations that took place in Basra and some other places in Iraq. We offer condolences to the families of the dead and wishes a speedy recovery to those injured. We call on the Iraqi authorities to respect the right of freedom of expression and allow people to participate in peaceful demonstrations free of threats, intimidation, or arbitrary detention. And it's also important that all political actors cooperate in establishing an inclusive government that will urgently address the people's demands for tangible reforms that would improve the daily lives of all Iraqis. And as I said, Mr. Kubish is very much following the matter. Yes, go ahead.
Several members of Security Council said that if a major military offensive, the result of major military offensive in Idlib, resulted in many civilian casualties, this could constitute a war crime. Does the Secretary General share same
I'm view? Not going into hypotheticals in terms, but we have seen violence and tragedy against the people of Syria for 8 years and more now. There have been crimes and incidents that could constitute war crimes that we have seen during this period. The Secretary General's message, Mr. De Mistura's message, John Ging's message, everyone's message from our end is that any military attack could create a catastrophic humanitarian situation. And I think Mr. Ging was very clear in those remarks. Carol.
Stefan, the North Korean mission put out a statement saying that they requested that the Secretary General circulate the Panmunjom Declaration as an official document of the UN. Has that been done? Is there a problem?
I will check. I will check. Usually, your member states routinely write to the Secretary General in his role as kind of secretariat role to circulate documents to the General Assembly, Security Council. That is usually done. Let me check on that particular request. Richard, and then we'll go.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Richard.
As is the custom of the UN and media, it's always two events, or three events, if you're lucky, at the same time. Monday, there's Venezuela's meeting and climate. I don't suppose a request to push the Secretary General's remarks to another time would be adhered to. And on Venezuela, can you give us the latest views from upstairs on where we stand as this meeting nears?
On Venezuela, the Secretary General's position on on Venezuela remains the same. Our humanitarian colleagues are working with countries in the region to trying to deal with the outflow of Venezuelans that we have seen, and his call for for an inclusive political dialogue in Venezuela stands as well. Yep.
Do you have a response to the latest statements by the Guatemalan government? Basically, they've said that the UN is trying to dictate how the country must be ruled through the Commission of Against Impunity.
No, I mean, Secretary General, I saw those comments made before those comments were made. The Secretary General has repeatedly said that he supports the work of the commission that is based on an agreement between Guatemala and the United Nations that was signed some years ago, and that position remains.
Just a follow-up, if I can. The government is saying that the UN should negotiate with them how to finish the work of this commission, which they don't support anymore. Are there conversations going on?
The UN is always open to receiving messages and listening to member states.
Stefan, I do have a question, obviously, on Kosovo, but I do have a follow-up on Syria as well. Mr. De Mistura described the situation in Idlib as perfect storm. I mean, why perfect storm? Storm is storm. It's always tragic. Why not tragic storm? Is he anticipating that, like in a movie, Idlib will sink or...
Well, we have to... Storm? I mean, the perfect storm is an expression.
Why not tragic storm?
The point is, whether it's a tragic storm or a perfect storm, the point is that it's a storm, and millions of civilians are at risk of great pain and great violence.
Okay, on Kosovo, I do have to ask you again, where does the Secretary General stand now with this dialogue that's supposed to go on between Belgrade and Pristina? However, today the news that we have out of Brussels that the Serbian delegation withdrew and went out of the dialogue. I know he's in support, but does he have to say anything?
Well,
in addition?
We have to check on those latest reports. I mean, we had always pushed for Belgrade and Pristina to continue to engage in the dialogue constructively and to make progress during this this meeting. The UN's, in terms of respect to Kosovo, the UN maintains its status of neutrality in line with the relevant Security Council resolution. And we're obviously following the meetings in Brussels, which are being led by the European Union.
Just quick follow-up. Many people are very concerned with the news and even intentions pronounced by the leaders from Pristina and Belgrade that they are ready for the new tailoring of the borders in the region. Some even are saying that it's opening of Pandora box for Bosnia and other countries like Macedonia. What does the Secretary General say on that?
There are processes in place, and I think member states should support the work together to respect those processes.
Is he concerned?
I'll leave it at that. Yes, sir. Yassine, and then...
Good afternoon, Stefan. Follow to Syria. Today they have a meeting between Russia and Iran and Turkey. Mm-hmm. Do you have any brief about that? Do you have any comments?
No, the UN was not represented at the meeting, and Mr. De Mistura was clear that he looks forward to getting a full debrief of the discussions that took place between the three leaders. We saw the press encounters, and I think we it was good to hear that there would be more dialogue taking place. Masoud, and then.
Yes, thanks, Stefan. On the Rohingya thing, that the Myanmar government has rejected the findings of the United Nations investigative team, and now this is also saying that it will not. I mean, it does not accept the purview of the International Criminal Court. What is the way forward over there in Rohingya in order to get Rohingyas back?
Well, I mean, I think it's what we outline is. First of all, first steps is creation of confidence-building measures for the Rohingya populations that remain in Rakhine State to ensure full access to the relevant UN agencies. And at the end of the day, it will be those Rohingya refugees that will have to make the determination, free from pressure, to go back voluntarily in dignity.
So in the meanwhile, the Rohingyas' fate will be hanging in balance. There's no resolution in the near future.
I'm not saying there's no resolution in the near future. We're working towards a resolution. Yes, ma'am.
Follow-up question for Serbian-Kosovo dialogue. The president of Serbia is maybe coming next week, mm-hmm, to U.S., and he's going to be here, and the Kosovo president maybe too. Last year, that was something between them when they were here in New York. And I'm asking the question, is going to be the same last year? Is UN involved in the talking between Serbian and president?
Let me check. I'm not aware that we're hosting any meeting, but I will check. Mr. Roth, then Mr. Varma.
If there was a leak, and there have been leaks, does the Secretary General favor lie detecting his top cabinet staff members?
I don't think I'll be hooked up just yet. Thank you. Thank you. Brendan, thank you.